Let's quickly check out what the front page stories are telling us this morning. The Daily Graphic says the ACP Agojo granted bail. ACP Dr. Agojo has been granted bail. Four perish in Galamsey Pit at Elembele. Four have perished. Pienim Yamsen wants dissolution of the Forest Committee. Remember the committee that received a lot of bash on social media and said that it was going to help to investigate why the city was falling. And we do know that the city has been falling since 1995, according to a Bloomberg report. So the Mr. Pienim and Mr. Yamsen, who are very respected economists, say dissolve the committee because it's useless. That's actually what they said. The African Free Trade Secretariat ready by March, President affirms at Investment Summit. And you know also that we're getting some money from the United Kingdom to run some project. The Daily Graphic, the back page says, operational factors force Ghana Water Company Limited to ration water. And for those of you who've been complaining to us in Mamprobi, in Dansoman, in Choco, in parts of Ashalibotri, and also parts of the Western region, if you're suffering from it, Ghana Water Company says there are operational difficulties, which is why we've been forced to ration water. But I'm sure you also know that we're told that Galamsey is creeping in with full force. Could that be the reason? I don't know. Your guess is not as good as mine. But mining of bauxite in Etiwa Forest, residents of communities protest. And yesterday, I'm sure you monitored all of that on TV3, the protest happening in the Eastern region. Even though Ghana, through GAADEC, has said that, well, they're going to ensure that proper planning is done so that people are not affected. The people say, don't mine bauxite. Leave it there like that, and let's keep our aluminium instead of turning it into a park. The Ghanaian Times, at the 2020 Ghana Investment Opportunity Summit in London, let's commit to intra-Africa trade. President is asking, and four Galamseyers trapped to death in a pit. ACP Dr. Agojo granted 500,000 bail. He's supposed to report to the IGP or the IGP's representative twice a week for 3 months, and then after once a week. So those are the bail conditions. And NDC, other parties demo against compilation of the new register. Let's see what's on the back page. Revised model standing orders for MMDAs launched in Accra. Yesterday, Ajia launched it. So this will guide all the MMDAs, your assemblyman, your DC, your MC, to ensure that they are all playing within the same field and nobody is trying to do what they like from where they sit, as I'm sure you have noticed that from the Public Accounts Committee. Kintampo Waterfalls attracts more tourists after it was refurbished. The Business and Financial Time. Refurbished Kintampo Waterfall sees surge in tourist visits. British Prime Minister, African leaders urge investors to accelerate economic role of the continent. And Ghana Year in Review 2019. And finally, on the front page of the Daily Guide, Opuni fertilizer drinkable. According to a witness, it said it was actually water. Agojo granted 500,000 bail. NDC in election violence rehearsal. And Nana gets £326 million from the United Kingdom for five projects. My guest this morning is the Honourable Member of Parliament for the Lejikuku constituency. He's also the board chairman for the Kalebu Teaching Hospital. And he's a very happy man because his road, which we've been reporting on for many, 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 many years, is now coming up quick and fast. Dr. Bernard Okuboy is my guest. And also the Honourable Murtala, he says Comrade Murtala Mohammed. That's what how he likes to be called. Is he is going to Parliament, hopefully, on the ticket of the NDC for the people of the Tamale Central. That's his wish, and he's here. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you very much.
You should have added that the road contract that was awarded by the NDC in Lejokoku.
Welcome.
Charlie, my brother. That's what I want. Even you don't even want contract.
But he started the work.
Yeah. Charlie, I'm happy to see you.
Happy to see you.
I wish you all the best things this particular year. In fact, I wish you 4 more years in your career, 4 more years in your marriage.
Who said my career is time bound?
I wish you 4 more plus years.
Listen, John,
I said 4 plus. At least 4 plus. And it's not politics. You two wish me 4.
Even when I'm 90, I can still practice.
But you wish him 4.
Wish me 4. It's not politics.
Just balance, reciprocity. How are you doing, gentlemen? How are the grounds? I mean, have you filed yet?
I'm strategizing, but we'll file. Okay. Hopefully, if not Friday, it will be early next week.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Interesting. You don't have a problem. You've cleared all the hurdles.
Well, we still have an elections to contest. Mm-hmm. But let me say good morning to you, my Lejo Kuku Jay-Z. In as much as I won't want to get into MPP's internal politics, I know that whoever emerges, we will beat the person. But I wish him well. He's a fine gentleman. He's one of the few honest MPP politicians I have come across. One of the few you rarely see honest politicians within the NPP.
And you're also one of the few from the NDC side.
Well, it's not about me, it's about him. Okay. When it comes to me, you can talk about me.
I'm asking now.
The issue is about him. So I don't know why you want to bring me in. Clearly, I think that he's a fine gentleman by all standards. So I can determine for their delegates.
Okay.
But I just wish him well. And we hope that they have a peaceful, parliamentary primaries. But this attempt to impose candidates on people, for me, I think it's not only undemocratic, it is an insult to the consistent, particularly the Ayawaso West Wagon, where is it the National Executive Committee took a decision that someone should contest. Right. You know, it is not the responsibility of national executive officers or anybody to determine to any constituency who represents them. I mean, if the people are convinced with the work the woman did, they would renew the mandate. But for them to take that decision, I think it is undemocratic. And I urge the NPP people there whose democratic rights have been denied by, decision.
It's their party.
Why? The constitution says that when you are elected as a member of parliament, you represent a constituent.
And the NDC has not done this before?
We have never. Yesterday, a journalist tried to say, we have never done that. This is a decision taken by the party, an official decision taken by the highest decision-making body of the party. I don't think that any political party has ever done that in Ghana. And NDC won't fathom even doing such a thing.
Doc, do you agree with him? Perhaps you did some cost-benefit analysis. You're looking at the pros and cons, and you're thinking, let's just go with her. Lydia Lassen, because she's already in there. What do you think?
No, I think, first of all, let me say a very good morning to all your viewers. I think in this democratic experiment, is a dynamic process. We ought to improve and amend, but it should be in the positive way, not the negative way. And if you have a by-election, assuming 1 year to an election, or just say 1.5 years to an election, you, God forbid, you lose a candidate. And then you go into an internal arrangement, get a candidate, and go into a main election. And your candidate wins. And let's say 6 months later, it's now time for primaries within our party.
Okay.
I mean, obviously, it will be very funny to say 6 months after having had a candidate who's gone for a general election, you are now going to repeat and start the process. And these are events that might not be in existence at the time you are crafting your internal laws. You understand? So me, what I always say is that you look at an arrangement and ask, is it progressive or not? I believe strongly, forget about politics, if it had been the NDC, PNC, you look at the sense in an arrangement. And I think this is something, look, I wouldn't be surprised if later they also adopt it. It's the way to go. It's just being rational and all that. Anyways, and the last time we lost our brother, Bwache Jako, I heard my colleagues on the other side say that we have to look at this arrangement where when an MP, like it's becomes late, you have to subject the whole constituency to another electoral processes. I heard some of them who said, let's see whether it's possible to say that, okay, if you lose a candidate within their party, they should elect someone to replace the person.
Fit or unfit?
No, you don't get it. It's not fit. There will be a process to elect within.
Okay.
Yes, within their party, since it's their seat.
So they bring a candidate to just replace and not hold the election.
Yes, exactly.
But that's not what the Constitution says. The Constitution says hold a by-election.
I'm not saying that is what the Constitution... I'm saying it's an experiment. Okay. The process...
Somebody is suggesting that.
Exactly. Okay. And both sides. People were like, look, because they looked at the background. You know, anytime one seat... When there's a by-election, the whole country, and it's because when you're having election for 275 seats, because the attention is evenly divided, you don't have a concentration of efforts.
Right.
You understand? And I heard some of my colleagues from the other side argue strongly that, look, going for, and just to bring your mind to the fact that every process ought to be dynamic. You shouldn't say that because these are remain from 92 to 100 years, that's what you are going with. These are things that we should ask.
Butala, what do you think?
If you want to
by election or
I think
or select a candidate to represent.
I really don't know who indeed suggested that, but I'm saying that the framers of the Constitution would have taken into consideration some of these issues. I think that for a constitution to be written, such as the 1992 Constitution is written, I believe that some of these things would have indeed been made known to them. And I stand to be corrected. We have had, you know, constitutions and democratic dispensations before in this country. I shudder to think that we might have experienced that before, either in the First Republic or the Second Republic or the Third Republic. Look, what the MPP has done is completely undemocratic. And these are people who pride themselves as the doyens of democratic dispensation in Ghana when they are practicing the direct opposite of what ought to be done. Why? In Tamale Central, when Professor Waisene left NDC and joined MPP, there was a by-elections in 2006. I was the youngest among the nine, you know, contestants. I lost to Honorable Inusa Fuseni. Honorable Inusa Fuseni came into Parliament as an MP who was elected through a by-elections. But when we had the elections in 2008, I contested Honorable Inusa again. Two of us contested him. We were three. The party didn't say because he came into Parliament through by-elections. Look, the decision to determine who represents people doesn't lie in the party. And what they have done is completely undemocratic. It's an insult to the people of Ayawasu constituency, whether NDC or MPP. And I urge them that if the MPP decides to impose a candidate on them, they should teach MPP a lesson, particularly the MPP activists in that country. And you know, Johnny, it's very important. University of Ghana, an academia, I mean, where you have intellectuals.
Are you hedging the people against?
No, I'm saying University of Ghana. Why? University of Ghana, where you have intellectuals, where you have people, you have all manner of people who are there. I think if they are listening and watching, that is an insult to them. That is disrespect to their views and the communities around. That is undemocratic.
There's been the argument
that undemocratic, look, and they ought to show this MPP a lesson.
There's been MPP
who urge them to vote against
the
and vote.
Most of the people on the University of Ghana campus come and vote and they go away because most of them don't actually live there. It's actually the people around the Bawaleshi and a bit of the
who live there, who suffer the brunt of the decision taken by. Interesting. There are a lot of coincidences you can point to. Same, go to Kantamanto. It's the same thing. People come there, they vote there. You go to where you have Abusokan.
Okay.
People come there because you see, it has to do with convenient. There are people who are from certain parts of this country who reside in Accra, but when it is time for election, they'll go to where they are coming from to do what? To vote. Okay. Must they also be determined who represents them? What the MPP has done is undemocratic.
It doesn't lie about this, should vote. Let me pick your quick thoughts about this. Would you be happy if what is happening in Ayas West Wogon happens in your constituency where they say, okay, Okoboy, step aside, let this candidate go? Would you be happy about
it? Yeah, I think it is fair that we are honest or straight with the special circumstance there.
Okay.
I mean, let the viewer appreciate that in my constituency, I mean, they've opened the contest for people to come and contest me. I am a Democrat. Mm. So I am one of those folks who tell people it is healthy. Let people come and compete once they show interest. Mm. That is why when you're a leader, you must have a relationship with your people. So that when you get contest, they can hold you. I remember one time I put it on one of my posts that those who made you, only they can keep you or sustain you.
Okay.
You know, so, but hers is a different...
There were people who contested her late husband.
No, I appreciate it.
And they were waiting for their time.
Yeah.
For 2020.
No problem. Yeah.
Those people have been shortchanged, someone will say.
Yeah. There's one thing we are forgetting, that her replacement of their husband was not automatic. It's not like they made it a family arrangement. Because your husband is the one who's passed, come and be the person. Mm. She went through a process.
Good process.
You understand?
No process.
Allow me to ventilate.
The process involved some engagements. It involved talking to, how do you call it, party people. It involved talking to delegates there.
Was it competitive?
Yeah, it was competitive. Oh. You know, I'm coming, just be patient. You know, you remember there were delegates who came on air, had some banter. Some of them said they were for a particular lady and all that. Mm. What happened was that the party went behind closed doors, met the delegates, and then associated itself with the candidate that had majority support from the delegates. It is only because she stood elections just some few months to this process. Mm. Unlike my situation. If she had been in my situation, they would have opened.
But one tenure has ended. Another is beginning.
Yeah, but good.
And we are making considerations from the old tenure.
Yeah, I think it's good to use the constitutional arrangement for presidents. Right. I think that will answer the question.
Okay.
When you are president and you are a vice president and you take over from the sitting president as a result of maybe infirmity or death, if you take over after 2 years, it is not counted as a term for you should you want to go for president.
Okay.
If you take over before 2 years, if 1 year into the presidency, the president is demised and you take over, it is counted as a full
but
term for
you. But
in
the matter of parliament, it is not counted like that.
No, you don't get me.
I'm saying that.
Yeah, it's just to appreciate.
But Dr. Okoboy, in the matter of the presidency, the rules are different.
No.
When you become a vice president, I mean, I remember Dominic Leto, he got into parliament under a certain arrangement.
Yeah.
And it didn't count as a remainder of somebody's tenure. It counted as a full. And then when he went into another primary subsequently.
When they were writing the constitution, you and I were not there. Most of the time, you know, I'm coming. Johnny, most of the time, in referring to.
From Dr.
Johnny, most of the time, in referencing constitutional provisions, we try to go into the motive or spirit behind. So we can, I'm not saying the two are the same, but just to appreciate the thinking that went into such an arrangement.
Okay.
That when you take over before 2 years, it's assumed that 3 years or more than 2 years is significant to be. To be counted as a good term, like a term for
Absolutely.
You. But after, assuming you take over 1 year to the term, it's not fair to say you've and I'm just trying to make an extrapolation that it's possible. I mean, it's just for us to appreciate the wisdom. And Johnny, please, let's be straight. There is nobody in the party that puts maybe extraordinary preference or, I mean, she's my sister. I have a very good relationship.
Oh, okay.
I can tell you boldly that it's not like people in the party love Al-Hassan more than, let's say, Dr. Okoboy or, let's say, Niti Wolo. Everybody is going for open contest. Even cabinet members are being contested.
The woman is not going for open contest.
Okay, let's make progress.
The woman is not going for open contest. And let's also be very clear.
Okay.
Let's be very, very clear. And this idea or attempt to compare... You know, apples and pebbles.
They are apples.
It can't even be. Or no, they are not.
Apples
and pebbles. Because you see, the framers of the
pebbles. In fact, pebbles on the beaches.
Poisonous pebbles. the framers of the constitution knew what they were doing. And Johnny, I said that we have had democratic elections before, and we have had republics before, and I'm saying that in all those, you know, republics that we have had in this country. I shudder to think that we would have experienced what we have experienced today. Look, you can compare that with what happened in Tamale Central. The only difference is that in Tamale Central, we didn't lose a candidate. But in this case, unfortunately, we lost a fine gentleman. He was my personal friend with whom I shared several debating, you know, platforms, even on University of Ghana campus, when I was a member of parliament and he was a member of parliament. Anytime they invited MPP and invited him, I debated with him, very fine gentleman. But I'm saying that, you see, they knew about this so-called empathy. The woman went into an election against the position of, you know,
let's say the candidate.
Against the position.
Let's not make it a woman and man thing.
No, she's a woman. I'm just saying.
But let's make a candidate.
Thank you. The candidate or the honorable member went into an election against the position of several other MPP people. How did they determine who has majority support from the delegates? He just said that the party went in for someone who had majority support from the delegates. How do you determine that when you didn't allow elections to be conducted?
Okay, thank you.
So I repeat, the MPP people in Ayawaso West were gone. they should vote against the MP to send a lesson to the national executive, such that they don't impose candidate on them.
You are crying more than a bereaved. 0021-666-333, that's our WhatsApp line. Join us and let's read your thoughts and comments in the rest of the wonderful world. So, page 20 of the Daily Graphic says, Pienim Yamson wants dissolution of Forex Committee. Two senior citizens have called on the government to dissolve the Foreign Exchange Development Committee, the FX Committee, that was inaugurated on January 13 this year to review the country's foreign exchange regime, identify constraints and workable alternatives that can reduce the risk in risk to the economy. Mr. Kwame Pienim, an economist and leading member of the New Patriotic Party, and Mr. Ismail Yamson is a management consultant and former board member of the Bank of Ghana, are making these ones. And they say it is unnecessary and a waste of our money. Dr. Okoboy, before we get into this conversation, I would like to run by you some statistics, because according to Bloomberg, the Ghanaian currency has been falling since 1995 from a record low of negative 28.87 all the way to 2019. Now we have 13.08%, and it's been falling. Doc, do you side with Mr. Yamson and Mr. Pienim?
Jerry, I'll address it shortly, but for the sake of your viewers, you know, this is a very big platform. Mm. In 2018, our sister went for primaries.
Okay.
And she won against five other contenders.
Okay.
Including Mr. Atu Williams, who I know very well, and Ya Echama, a lady. So she went for open contest.
Okay. But why did you say that the national executive supported a candidate?
No.
Okay, so he's clarified his point.
There were, in fact, initially, people were rooting that a particular person should be allowed to go. That's why I said they were consulting.
The wives. The other wife.
No problem.
Okay. People had problems as to who they should support. Yes. Mm. But yeah. I'm saying that you are not wrong entirely. Yeah. The National Executive or MPP at that time didn't hide their open support for the MP. Okay.
I think we've had enough of this issue.
The clarity was that
But then there also the other concern would be that those who went for the primaries may also be interested in the 2020
debate. I've argued on that it's because of the time that if it had been the whole period.
Okay, so two senior citizens have called for the government to dissolve the FX committee. Mr. Pienim particularly says that aside what the structure of the committee looks like, he finds the composition, how it was put together, very, very questionable. And you should kick it out.
Good morning to Senor Malasa. Okay. I wish her all the best.
Okay. In
the
say what?
Senor Malasa, Mrs.
Is this Serum or is this Senor?
It's Senor.
Can we make progress?
Yeah. All right.
To dissolve or not to dissolve?
General, usually my position is that no matter how astute you are on a particular topic, if anybody approaches you with some information, it doesn't hurt to listen. That's my attitude.
Okay.
In medicine, politics, family, everything. Once it's not coming to take out what I have, but might add, I'm choosing my words well, might, which means it's possible to add nothing.
Okay.
I always give the room for to hear.
In this case, they're asking for you to take away the committee.
So just I give a background.
Because you have cabinet members.
No problem.
And also chief directors and everybody else on the committee. It's asking, what kind of committee is this?
I used to be like that, very impatient. Relax, I'm coming to that.
I've changed. Because your road has been constructed.
So, the point is that, yes, I've heard the arguments. Mm. We have cabinet. Some even said, look, the person with the entity with the mandate to handle foreign exchange regime and corrections is the central bank. I've heard folks who say the finance minister was involved in the appointment of the board of directors of BOG.
Mm-hmm.
And so they should have made sure they had people who could help. I mean, almost all the points, arguments I've heard, Johnny, are valid.
Mm.
You get my point. Almost all are valid. When I say valid, none of them spoke I mean, wrongly or misinformed us.
So why are we holding on to the committee?
Coming. Yeah, yeah. So this is my point. It is very possible that this committee, in the multitude of ideas, can come up with something that maybe, with all our appreciation of issues, we might not have maybe necessarily contemplated or applied. You know what I mean? So that's my attitude. It's possible that they can come with 20 measures, and the one who set it up already is working on 18 of them. You get what I mean? So
his argument is that the vice president was a former deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana.
Yeah, yeah.
So he could obviously think about what the committee is going
to
do.
About.
So we don't need a committee.
You see, my point is that I started by saying that with all my knowledge on an issue, I always am open to consultation or discussions, especially when it's coming from a body that I know have a background. Look, most of the folks, I listened to our very senior PNE, the economist, who said most of them are very busy folks, and that you have the agric minister, you might not have time and all that. I listen. I mean, some of them make a lot of sense. But I also ask myself, is it possible that they are coming together, we'll let them stop thinking or acting like they are in their own world, and then now bring the thing interconnect. I mean, to be global in their thinking. I mean, there are things that could come out of this. Look, when we went to Senshi, to think about this country and all that. Yeah, those times there were even also folks from outside who said, why do you go there and all that? But the bottom line is that there were a few things that might have come out from Senshi that the then finance minister might not have contemplated. Even if he had contemplated, might not have prioritized. You get what I mean? So I think as a country, there are some things we should not push or split our heads over.
Okay.
And this point that, they'll be drinking tea and all that, I mean, let's sometimes, you know, fortunately, their tea will not be like the 1.7 billion, the one we drank right after the 2008 elections.
Transition.
You know, the year transition. That one was.
Mr. Pieni thinks that in the last and final year of your tenure, you should not be soliciting for ideas. You should be zooming into action and delivering on your mandate as opposed to. So now it's more like you're making up excuses for what you should have done in 2017.
Johnny, look.
What do you say to that?
Look. The same folks. If you watch my approach, I have total respect for YAMC. These were people who were into top management before I even started school, some of them.
Right.
So these are folks. Johnny, almost all the points that have been raised have some validity, that you have structures in place. Why do you want to put this together? But also, with all their experience, I've added that sometimes you get good counsel, no matter how good you are at a particular subject, if people come together. And this argument about cost, we should be careful not to use drinking of coffee or tea to ridicule everything and say you spend money on all
but
that.
But it will happen.
No. I mean, I know, but it's cost-benefit analysis. It's possible that you spend some money on tea, you get a lot of good counsel. And please, let's be honest with ourselves. If you meet Impini and Yamsin and ask them, Mr. Yamsin, comparing the shape of Ghana's economy before, prior to Akufo-Addo's coming, and now, I'm honest, I'm absolutely sure that I will tell you that this economy is not perfect, but it's in a better shape than it was before.
Really?
No, I'm coming. I'm making this point for you to appreciate the fact that it's not like the economy is so worse off. That is why we are running to a group. We are running to a group because we appreciate that you can always do better at anything you are doing. That is why we are forming this group.
So somebody I met says, look, you are looking at cleaning the black market, and so you have Forex traders on the committee.
Yeah.
You are looking at making sure that your markets are clean.
Yeah.
So you have market women there. And he says, do you honestly think that the people who are benefiting from the loopholes will teach you how to block the loopholes that they are benefiting from? Somebody is asking that.
Johnny, there's one thing I'm happy about. I remember I listened to some of the speeches of Prof. Mills. I remember some of the speeches of President Kufuor when it comes to the structure of our economy and the forex regime, in terms of the foreign exchange regime. I've listened to President Akufo-Addo and JM when he was president. One theme that runs through all of them is that to get a real hold on our forex regime, there must be transformation of this, our economy, from this agrarian, more or less,
society, industrialization.
To one that also is very competitive and adds value. We have made a lot of effort in doing that in this President Akufo Addo's regime. The fact that we are still having to deal with the Forex and all that means that maybe we have to accelerate, or is the extent. Like I said, anyone listen to their speech, all of them say that the structure of the economy is responsible. But you see, I am one of those people who have argued that your economic management as a government has an influence also on the Forex regime. There are local forces that determine the dollar's strength against the cedi. There are external forces. Some time ago, Dr. Bamia pointed to some of the forces and said, these are within your control. Because you've not done well with them, you are suffering the forex. And he pointed to some of them. Your inflation cannot be going up, and yet you tell us that your forex is cool.
So I want to ask a question.
Yes.
Here's a government that says we're doing Ghana Beyond Aid.
Yes.
We're doing one district, one factory.
Yeah.
We're trying to improve industrialization, yes, to add value to our local,
yes,
raw materials.
Yes.
And this same government goes to the ports to reduce benchmark values to encourage importation, which will cost us some more money.
Yeah.
How do we reconcile the two?
Yeah.
One vision on one breath to say you want to industrialize and keep everything here, planting for food and jobs, export and rural development, blah, blah, blah. And you know it's cheaper to export and much more expensive to import. Now you have reduced benchmark values, and which will weaken our city.
Yeah. Johnny,
you're singing two songs with one voice.
I'm happy my brother is here. He's been at trade before. Fortunately, unfortunately, managing a country is not an equation in one variable. It's a complex equation. Johnny, if anybody says that when this government reduced benchmark values, our motivation was to make our city weak and to allow a flooding of import, that fellow is not being fair to
us. What was the motive?
You know.
I don't know. Tell me.
I'll remind you. You were in this country. That's why I'm happy it's been a trade. There was enormous pressure from most, especially Guta, most of the people who are into, how do you call it, commodities. And the argument was that the charges at our ports had an influence on the rates we see at the market, the retail.
Right.
And so after a lot of consultations, what we decided to do was to try and then deal with some of the charges so that it will be reflected in lower prices. Every policy can have unintended consequence. When the unintended come, it's not fair to say that it was the sole motive for the policy. He knows. So reviews are there. When we did the benchmark, I mean, there were folks who posted on social media, wow, I went to the port and it's real. I cleared a Corolla for, let's say, a lower value. But our intention was not to displace, let's say, a local person who is into automobile. So that's a complex equation. When you come with a policy to address a problem and it affects, let's say, negatively, another part, what you do is to sit, take a critical look and do your reviews. That is what you have to do.
Okay, Mutala, step in for me. The two gentlemen, respected senior citizens and economists, they're saying, look, a committee is not necessary and it's actually a wasteful venture for us. Dr. Obubuai says, well, the ideas are fine, we take them, but in unity, a lot more ideas will come up. What do you think, especially knowing that you've been a former deputy minister for trade? What are your own views about this? Do we need this committee?
Well, let me say good morning to you and to my friend and, of course, the good people of Tamale Central and your viewing public, and also congratulate them for the massive turnout we had in the Tokusai demonstration, you know, just some 2 weeks ago. You see, listening to my brother and listening to the NPP, they behave like the typical sociological theorist. They try to treat people suffering as an academic exercise. They ponder the pain and the suffering of the Ghanaian people from a distance. So for them, they need to chain out so-called economic figures, and that is enough a justification to showcase to the people of this country how well they are doing. Did he say, if we ask these two eminent individuals, whether the shape of our economy today as compared to the 2016 is better, they will say this one. This is not only bad, it's a disaster. It's a disaster because, I'll tell you, you see, the purpose for any economic policy by any government is not about the niceties of it. The sweetness of the soup is not how it looks, it's in the what? In the eating. So when you come out and brandish figures, some of the figures that are cooked, you come out and brandish them, people want to see a reflection of what you have done in their pockets. Please, when we are discussing about the city, I beg you, don't bring Dr. Baumia in.
Why not?
He has no credibility. He has no, I'm not questioning.
Please,
please.
No.
Well, he has no credibility. I have every right to say that. I'm not questioning how Edoyan, he can be a professor emeritus in economics. That's not my interest. We were told he restructured Zimbabwean economy. We were told by the same MPP folks. No wonder Zimbabwe is where it is today. So I beg you, when we are talking about the economy, don't even bring him there. He's a disaster. He said that when the fundamentals of our economy are weak, the exchange rate will expose you. The exchange rate has exposed you people in a legendary fashion. But you see, there's even
start today. It started in 1995.
Well, that is not
according
my. That
to
is
Bloomberg.
Not. We are going to compare what they inherited and what we are experiencing today. What the government has done is even a violation of the 1992 Constitution.
Wow.
Read Article 183, Clause 2, and Article 184 of the 1992 Constitution. In fact, the right to determine whether a committee or whatever is set up to look at how the city or our domestic currency is regulated is absolutely the right of the Bank of Ghana. Absolutely. Not any other person. In any case, read Article 184 of the 1992 Constitution. Also tells you that for even if there is the need for any committee to be set as we are experiencing today, Parliament should be aware. In fact, Parliament has a role. Government is also having a responsibility to report to Parliament every single year. 2 years, ask them whether they have done anything like that. So there's even a violation of the 1992 Constitution. How come that in this, the manager, the chairman of the economic management team, has indeed been included in law? Is not even anywhere near that. It is the clear manifestation.
But the Bank of Ghana knows its rights.
Please,
it knows its autonomy, and yet they agreed to be on the committee.
You see, President Nanado is not behaving like a president. He's behaving like a king. That is the sort of Ghana we live in. Look, when you want to talk about rule of law, they preach that they are Democrats. We just discussed an imposition of a candidate on the people of Ayewaso. They will preach one thing and they do direct the opposite.
I am saying that
spare me this idea of the Bank of Ghana not knowing. I just made references to constitutional.
I have not said the Bank of Ghana. I'm saying that you are quoting constitutional provisions. I'm saying that the Bank of Ghana is fully aware of their mandate and their authority.
So they allow
and autonomy.
Who appoints
so
the committee?
Why are they on the committee? I mean, if you are invited to join the committee, you can decline.
Look,
or accept.
If I can borrow Honorable Adongo's word, the danger to the economy of this country is the governor of Bank of Ghana and the Minister of Finance. But I won't be detracted. I will still make the point I want to make. Since he made reference.
Why did he say that?
Oh, please. We have seen even how figures are cooked up. Figures are cooked up. They report without giving us detailed information as what they are supposed to do. I just told you that they ought to be reporting to Parliament about it. They haven't done that the past 2 years. Why haven't they done that? But you see, since he mentioned that at the Minister of Trade, I feel sad to say that we will never get out of this entanglement because of the actions and inactions of this corrupt and incompetent
Why
government.
So?
Johnny, in 2016, in fact, 2008, when we had elections in which the NDC won from MPP, we were spending $500 to $550 million importing rice into this country.
Right.
The NDC was able to at least reduce it. By 2016, we were spending $450 to $500 million importing rice into this country. But the Minister of Agri's own record, we are spending over $1 billion importing rice into this country.
$1.3 billion.
I mean, this is ridiculous. Within the period of 3 years, you know what the NDC did? When we inherited $500 to $550 million, sometimes $600 million under NPP President Kufuor, we reduced it 8 years. We reduced it to $450 to $500 million. And within a period of 3 years, we are spending over $1 billion.
The president says,
Can I finish?
I have seen this. I've seen that there's been a boom in local rice
production. That is another false statement.
Allow me to ask my question. And so I am directed that all ministries, departments, and agencies compulsorily consume local rice to help boost our local rice and reduce imports.
You see, it's sad That is another false statement, unfortunately and sadly, made by His Excellency the President. I wonder those who are giving him this information. There wasn't any boom in local rice production. What actually happened? Avnage, there is a company that mills rice. Avnage had everything under the NDC. And Avnage used to buy the rice that is produced by the three northern regions, now five northern regions. Now, Avnage can no longer buy because when they buy and process, they can't compete because this government has allowed their financiers to be importing rice into this country. And this statement was made by a lecturer from UDS. The Minister of Trade had a ban. We had a restriction on the importation of rice into this country. What has this government done? They disregarded that restriction, allowed the people because they financed their elections. I mean, is it not ridiculous?
You cannot say
Johnny,
that.
Johnny, is it not ridiculous?
You cannot say
Johnny,
that because people funded
Johnny,
elections.
I am saying that a lecturer from the University of Ghana, University for Development Studies, made this statement.
Did he mention names?
Oh, please. When you have a lecturer of a university, who comes out to say that the NPP, because those people finance the NPP, why? Don't we have a Minister of Communication? Not a single rebuttal to that allegation made by the lecturer. But is it not ridiculous that between $450 to $500 million importing rice into this country, within the period of 3 years, we are spending over $1 billion importing rice into this country. And you tell me that we can ever get away from this triangle. You know what the NDC...
The president has given a directive.
Everybody
consume local rice.
Johnny, I have just told you the idea that there was a bumper harvest of rice was another false, another deceit, another conning by this government. I have told you, Avnage buy rice that is produced by farmers in the five northern regions. Avnage stated they could no longer buy rice from them because when they buy to mill them, when they buy to mill, they can't compete because the floodgates have been opened for all manner of people to bring in rice into this country. So Avnage didn't buy. And that occasion, the idea that farmers produce and they didn't have market for them. Yet we were told by the minister and the president, oh yes, there is a bumper harvest. That is not true. Again, Johnny,
quickly, so
what the NDC did, look, you see, President Mahama is visionary, million miles away, this incompetent president.
We're not discussing him. We're discussing whether the committee is relevant,
Johnny,
or not.
We are discussing what they have done. He just said they should compare the record. Who was the president and who is the president now? So we are discussing the two people. President Mahama.
Do we need the committee?
I have just told you it's even a constitutional violation of it. Okay. But let me make this point. President Mahama realized that we're spending so much money in importing drugs into this country. Our pharmaceutical industry produced drugs that met the WHO standard. So what President Mahama then did, we had under Honorable Haruna Idrisu, now the minority leader, meeting was held with the pharmaceutical companies. Committees were set up to identify why they are not producing to meet the domestic market, let alone exporting into the sub-region. Now, it became very clear that in as much as they were doing very well, they didn't have the capacity financially. NDC government under President Mahama gave direct financial assistance, money to this pharmaceutical company to expand. You know why? We did that so that they will be able to produce more. The amount of money we spent in importing drugs into this country at least would have reduced
and
a bit.
And when the central medical stores went up in fire.
All those things, but I'm just saying
we couldn't
that.
Find
I'm
the,
just
the,
saying that.
The people who set it up on fire.
Right.
We
have just had the VAT building that went on fire. Have we found? I mean, please don't.
So I'm saying
don't
that look,
it has got nothing to do with the discussion.
Botala, you're giving support to pharmaceutical companies to produce locally what we have been importing. That's good. I'm saying that. And at the time when the central medical stores got up in flames, all that money went away. We have not up until now held anybody by the neck to say,
Johnny, that's money. You have every right to raise that. What has that got to do with the point I'm making?
But if we are abusing...
Do you want me
to
begin? That is why I mentioned the VAT building. Should we talk about it? Please, I beg you.
So we should not talk about
it. I'm saying that
those.
We can talk about that on a different topic.
Okay.
I am saying that what President Mahama did, we did this. We were able to give direct financial assistance to this pharmaceutical company. And you see, Johnny, the measures put in place
by
the NDC
let's
government,
wrap up. So
and you can check the records in 2014, there was a surge in the production of local rice in this country by 60%. And there was a reduction in the importation of local rice by 40%. That's a direct correlation. This is what we call visionary. Look, this government doesn't have any vision. It can't even, they can't even
fathom. The president's travel. Directive means nothing
they don't
to you.
Absolutely. What they are doing is what I describe as cartoon scenario reality.
Okay.
What they do is that they preach to the people of this country, Ghana beyond aid. Mm. Yet we are handcuffed in hand everywhere, okay. Begging for aid. We can, I'm sorry, I have to raise this issue, Johnny.
Thank you.
That it is sad that we are all struggling. I would be happy to see our city having some value. But with the actions of this government, the city cannot have a value. Ban, reintroduce the restriction that we impose on the importation of rice by the ministry. That was what we did. You threw this thing to dogs, and then you sit down
the trade
and
minister
cry.
Is part of the committee. Maybe that will be
one district, one for which factory have they built?
Okay, where? Crystal, all right, read some message. You know, you have a rebuttal.
After all.
You have a rebuttal. After but you had your day, and then you have a final say, and then we'll close.
All right, so we'll take viewers' comments coming in on our WhatsApp. This morning says, good morning, TV3 and your lovely viewers. Please ask Honorable Mutala what happened with George Boateng when George Boateng picked form to contest ex-president Mahama in 2015 in their presidential primaries. This man was a former NDC branch executive. Can we say it was undemocratic as far as the NDC is concerned? Asiedu Nketiah described George Boateng as mad, hypocrisy as the highest level. We haven't forgotten. Good morning, TV3. We don't need any new register. This decision is so annoying. Drop that decision and distribute the ambulances to save lives. Greetings to my incoming MP for Tamale Central, Comrade Salah Mohammed from Osman Bukurusung in Tamale. Good morning, Johnny, and good morning to Honorable Muntala and Eko. When has Ghana started double track of economic management team? Green track is government-owned economic team led by Baumia, and the gold track is the FX team. But I tell you, if I was Baumia, I wouldn't have come on TV or better resign. Baumia knows no shame from Mohammed Adam Haruna in Niendi. Good morning, Johnny. The compilation of a new voters register is a must according to the EC. They have decided and it stands. Go to court if you disagree with same. This voter register issue is consuming much time, which should have been used to discuss solutions to persistent unemployment and injustice in our societies. That's from Efa Isaac Atrima. Thank you so much for helping
go.
Me.
Let's go.
Let's move on. Good morning, Johnny. Why is Mutala not contesting the Nantong seats, but rather Tamale Central? Exactly. Economic management isn't about empty rhetoric. Isn't it amazing that under the all-knowing Dr. Baumia, as many as 40 people would be put together to investigate the city's free fall? A man who could organize a lecture on how to restore the value of the city is today shelved aside. God has exposed every lie the NPP told in opposition. My regards to lawyer Alfred Tua Yeboa of Sunyani East NPP. That's from Barima Kubaji. From Yamoha in Wa, the government is now setting a committee to look into the problems of the city, and by the time they submit their report, it would have been left with about 7 months to leave office. This is usurpation of the economic management team and that of the Bank of Ghana. This is indeed a useless government. Good morning, Johnny. I like Mutala's posture and demeanor this morning. The noise and emotionalism doesn't fit him at all, but I salute Doctor for making my day. That's from Matthias Bukhari from Tempani. Good morning, TV3 and Johnny. Isn't it interesting that a whole committee is set up to investigate the volatility of our currency? We are paying some people with our taxes for nothing. That's from Louis Ndome. Good morning, Mr. Johnny. I've missed you for a while. Welcome back. I hope the EC will listen to Ghanaians. They should know that we have only one Ghana. My greetings to Honorable Mutala Mohammed. This is Alaji Ali from Tamale Bukurisung. Johnny, good morning. Kindly tell Dr. Okoboy that I don't have a job now. Economy or no economy, the votes will expose them come December. That's from Mahama Adams in Wa. From Elom Gideon in Dunkwa Ofin Central Region. Good morning, Johnny. I love the way you ask them questions for your viewers. Great job. And the last for this morning. Good morning, TV3. Setting this committee is needless. They only want to cause financial loss to the state. Is Dr. Baumia economics went or retirement? Okay. Jacob Abane from Biduri. Greetings to Dr. Robert Kuganalem.
Thank you. Very much.
Pardon me if I got the names wrong.
Doctor, take a bite on this one. No, you have a final bite. But you were the last person who spoke. Doc, the EIU is predicting that the city will fall some more in this year. Yeah, that's what the EIU says.
Yeah.
And you have put together a committee. Some are saying the committee is needless. you are insisting that, well, a multiplicity of ideas could bring the solution that we desire.
Somebody,
and then one of the texters says, look, we are paying people to look at the free fall of the city already. Why do we set up a 40-member committee to look at it? Your closing thoughts.
You know, someone just sent a message that Muntaka, you know, it was a problem having someone contesting. The NDC were involved in all kinds of
things. It's not true.
Yeah, so it's not when you are closing, you are running, and you can it's assist. Not true. They asked me, but I don't
but my question. My very good friend who used to work at the Flagstaff House, Manaf, was also asked not to contest.
Yeah, no, that's what I said. In
so, don't make equalization.
Who asked him not to contest?
I don't know.
Was it the NDC?
I don't know.
This is the national executive of the MPP that took an official position.
Can we make progress? So we agree that on both sides, there are a few of them. Let's make progress. I'm asking a question. I'm saying the EIU says that, Economic Intelligence Unit says that the city will fall some more in this year. We have set up a committee. People say the committee is not necessary. You insist that a multiplicity of ideas could bring a solution.
You know,
but a texter thinks that we are paying people already at the Bank of Ghana and other places to handle this. Why the committee? Closing thoughts.
When we went to Sinch, we were paying people already. That's what I'm saying, that when I have knowledge on a subject, almost absolute knowledge, I still don't close my door to, inputs. I've made that point.
Okay.
So for me, I don't see, the comments made by most people are valid in that they think that it's not necessary, but I think it's okay. Now, the single most, in quote, I use the word, irritating person for the NDC, the person that touches their nerve, the person that reminds them so much of their loss, the person that was so key in exposing their main weakness was Dr. Bawumia. When you mention him, their emotions come up. And I appreciate that because we are human beings. He's not a perfect person, but the man is full of a lot of things.
Is that your answer to
No, I'm coming. I will answer your question. I just wanted to appreciate why when it comes, they get emotional.
Okay.
Because he was key to exposing their weakness, which was economic mismanagement. Mm-hmm. You know what? Handling a country is like dealing with a patient. Once the patient is on the bed, there are a few things you use to tell how well they are doing. Johnny, and these things are universal. A doctor will refer to your blood pressure and temperature, whether you are in Ghana or China or the US. These are indicators. It's the same with the economy. Whether you like it or not, we'll look at your inflation. We are going to look at your deficit. We'll look at your surplus. We'll look at your GDP growth. All these things are real. And when you were there, the indicators were clear. They've been improved now.
Which indicators?
Your growth was 3.7. It's been doubled to over 7. You were doing 3.5 end of 2016 when you left. Now it's 3. It's about 7. You know, Johnny? So that is the point I want to make, that the patient is not, let's say, running a marathon now, as in an excellent
condition.
But
we were told that the city had, the dollar had been arrested. Key had been given, Johnny, to IGP.
Allow me to answer. EIU, I don't begrudge their, what's the name? Their predictions and all that. What I don't want to get to, because I know it doesn't help a lot of people, people are not interested, is who is doing well with managing the depreciation. I don't want to get into that. When our opponents push us, sometimes because we do comparative politics, you might be pushed to look at the fall. So that
which the people are getting tired.
No, I know. John, I know. I will not go there. But my point is that there are forces, domestic and forces external, that determine whether your currency holds against others. Most of the domestic forces, if not all, we have done well to be on top of them.
You build factories?
Oh, when
industrialization
means
factories. So we are not importing.
But when I talk about,
we are not importing food, when I talk about rice,
Johnny,
oil, sugar.
Johnny, but who said so? You
it's industrialization.
You close the gap, please. This watermelon factory at Wale, what it's going to do is that if you were going to, the one that was, is a 35 million from Exim Bank. Okay. I mean, this is not, these are, they are documents. You understand?
President
So how close have you closed the gap?
No.
By what percentage?
Good.
I want to learn.
Yeah, excellent. I mean, so these are the things that we can discuss.
I want to learn. How have you closed the gap?
What I can tell you is that when Efutu is full stream, it's going to reduce the extent of imported food.
One factory.
No. Oh, but you want me to list, is it only, have you not heard of Twyford? Have you not heard of the potato, the casa di ropa?
The Twyford up that ceramics?
Yes, at Takwadi.
And
the... No.
Yes, their capacity was almost quadrupled when we came. You know that?
Okay. So quadrupled. You've added on to what they have.
Oh, Johnny, that's what you do. Let's be honest with ourselves. You are not going to get any government that comes into office and within even 8 years, eradicates or eliminates every gap.
Okay.
Let's be fair with ourselves.
Has the city broken jail?
No. The last time I checked, the city was on remand. The last time I checked.
It's on remand?
Yes.
Okay, all right.
It's not good.
The city is now in a confined solitary.
But Allah, your closing thoughts. Somebody says a certain gentleman wanted to contest President Mahama.
I'm saying that.
And you,
yes.
You didn't allow him, so you don't have the moral.
First and foremost, that is not even true. Don't compare the two. I remember yesterday, another journalist, you know, raised that issue. The NDs, in fact, even the MPP have indicated that they have certain standards, and the standards in conducting an elections are set up by the national executive.
Answer the question, stop comparing.
They say, oh, can I answer?
We don't have time.
You don't have time.
When he was talking, did you tell him?
I will ask you to
I'm saying that. In going into an elections, you set up a committee. The national executive and the elections directorate will come. And what is even critical is that the person should be a person of standing.
Okay.
In the matter of the gentleman they make reference to, even his conscience said that he wasn't doing anything in the party, even though he's somebody who lived, but he has never participated in any activity of the party within the constituency. And these things matter. Now, if you want to contest, even as a member of parliament, and you don't meet this criteria, in every parliamentary vetting, he will tell you, okay. They would want to find out what you have done. So if a person was not deemed to be qualified to contest as a member of parliament, okay. How could such a person be allowed to contest as the presidential candidate? But let me make...
You've answered that way forward.
You see, he talks about figures. The people of this country, I started by saying that they are not interested in how inflation is rising. They are not interested in how the city, what they are interested in. How much was I paying for Trotro from Adenta to the ministries under the NDC? How much is it now? It has doubled. How much was I paying for a gallon of petrol under the NDC as a taxi driver, a Trotro driver, a Uber operator, or even a commercial driver, or even a private person who uses your vehicle? It was 14 cedis, it is now 25, 26 cedis. How much was I paying for the items I was buying, because people buy the items, cut them from other places here? How much am I paying now?
Is that not an oversimplification? No. Of what could have been external forces.
The purpose, didn't we have the external forces under the NDC? Or the NDC was in a room that external forces were so immune. We had same external forces. It is the clearest indication that this government is a disaster. He said that the NDC is afraid of Dr. Baumia. As a matter of fact, he's an apology of a vice president. And we means no worse in saying, you see, Johnny, last point. Clowns are not in high demand these days. But I can assure you, you find a lot in the NPP. And the classical example is our vice. For him, when you are talking about the economy, I'm saying that.
It's not.
So we borrow me a word, then I use it.
Well, we don't have words for you.
Okay, I'm saying that.
Can you withdraw that?
It's not correct.
If he feels uncomfortable with that.
No, my viewers feel uncomfortable. I feel uncomfortable.
Be determined to the viewers. If you and he feel uncomfortable, and if some of your viewers feel uncomfortable, I withdraw that. But let me reiterate.
You cannot reiterate.
It's a disaster.
You don't reiterate what you have withdrawn. Dr. Okobo, in the meantime, says the city is on remand. The city is on remand.
Solitary confinement. They put you in a jail alone.
Dr. Bernard Okobo is the Honorable Member of Parliament for the Lejokuku constituency in the Greater Accra region. He's been here on the ticket of the NPP, and he's also the board chair for the Kolebu Teaching Hospital. One day we'll have a full discussion about the Kolebu Teaching Hospital and whether things have improved or deteriorated, and whether there are still Goro boys running around the place.
Nursing training college. You remember?
Okay, yes.
He hasn't provided.
We'll talk about that.
Have you set up an investigation?
Mutala Mohammed is aspiring member of parliament on the ticket of the NDC for the Tamale Central constituency. Gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for your time.